I am surrounded by the death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor powers nor things present nor things to come, nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation, will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. We brought nothing into the world, and we take nothing out. The Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. But now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know, even as I am also known. None of us lives to himself. None of us dies to himself. If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. We believe that Jesus died and rose again. So it will be for those who died as Christians. God will bring them to life with Jesus. Thus we shall always be with the Lord. Comfort one another with these words. We now bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, in your Son Jesus Christ, you have given us a true faith and a sure hope. You help us to live as those who believe in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to eternal life. And strengthen this faith and hope in us all the days of our life. Through the love of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Please be seated for a brief moment. Good morning, everyone. Here, as we gather in this chapel, we are grateful that we have finally the opportunity to celebrate the life of Carol and Damon, and then to come to that point that we can do the cremation of our earthly remains. We pray that God bless us as we gather on this name, or in his name, and on this occasion we welcome all of you very warmly to the service. We also express our condolences to the direct family and to the extended family and all of us who are gathered here on this occasion. Our first theme will be Blessed Assurance. It will be on the screen, and immediately after the hymn, Kayla will do the eulogy.
Good morning, everybody. My mom was born on the 8th of January, 1964. She was born to Leslie and Lorraine Fraser. She was the youngest of three siblings. She matriculated in 1982, studying nursing in 1983, and then she went on to work in the financial industry from 1988. Whoever needed something from my mom, whether it was her siblings, my brother and I, her nieces or nephews, they knew they could come to her. Whether it was advice, they knew that she was always there for them. I sometimes remember it used to be so bizarre. I would be sitting in my room and I would hear offering to pay people's rent or even to pay off their car or some debt that they had. That was my mom. She would put herself last for her fellow men, and she often would say, when people come to the house, you don't turn them away. If we've got, we give it. I remember when my brother and I were growing up, we would very seldomly have to go to a doctor. She was our doctor, she was our mommy, but she was also our best friend. She always had an open door policy, and we knew that if we had a problem, if we did something wrong, even if we knew she'd be angry, we could go to her. I always called her a delayed reactor, because I would tell her something and a week or two later she would only tell me I actually made her upset. I went through my mom's phone about a week ago, and I saw that she had already ordered myself a birthday cake, and she was planning Brandon's 30th. That was my mom, doing her best for her kids. My mom hardly went out with her work colleagues or friends. She was always there, devoted to her family. She would advise everybody, if you were sick, she'd tell you what medicine you must take. Often, many years ago, my granny would call on a Friday night and ask if we're coming to play dominoes. 5 minutes, we're all in the car on our way. That's my mom. She was a strong role model for Brandon and I, and no matter how bad things would get, she would always do her best to assure us that she was there and everything would be okay. We knew that she would always be by our sides. Auntie Sean mentioned the times when she would sleep over at our home. She and my mom would cook and bake and chat till the early hours of the morning. Her nature was such of giving and always putting the needs of others before her own, always sending inspirational messages of hope and love to everybody. When Auntie Sean and my mom would go in the shops, they would fight over who was going to pay for the things. In the end, I'd get so fed up, I'd say, there you go again, Auntie Sean, you're not going to win with her. Auntie Sham said she always remembered how they used to travel to primary school with Uncle Ronnie, who was a teacher in town. She said it was always so funny when she and my mom would sit in the back and the car was full of all the cousins, and in the rearview mirror they could see their big red bows with plaits on either side that my mom made sure was neat. They had to sit really still in order to get that hair looking good. A day's growing up with my mom was more than special. It was loving. Auntie Sham mentioned how she and my mommy would have pillow fights with Uncle Robin. She said, shame, he didn't even stand a chance. Being two girls, they outnumbered him. Whenever my mom and Auntie Sham would speak on the phone and Auntie Sham would say something funny, my mom always would say, sis, you're making me laugh so lekker now. That was my mommy, always at time for everybody. Dr. Frederick Aguta put it very nicely. A soul continues to live in us for love, hard work, and kindness, and friendship, and our uniqueness. We'll never forget you, and Brandon and I will always make you proud. Thank you for being the wonderful mother that you were. You are irreplaceable.
We will now have a solo by Michael on Eagle's Wings. It's to be preceded by the Lightning of the candles. What I suggest we're going to do is that we combine the two so that as Michael do the solo, those appointed for to do the lighting of the candles can come forward and light the candles. Thank you.
Thank you.
I read to you an abbreviated version from the Gospel of St. Luke, chapter 24, verse 13 to 31. On Easter Sunday, two of Jesus' disciples were going to a village called Emmaus, about 70 miles from Jerusalem, and talking about all that had happened. While they were talking, Jesus himself came near and went with them. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him. He said to them, "What are you discussing while you are walking along?" They said, "About Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet mighty in deed and word before God and all the people. And how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be crucified. We had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. It is now the third day since these things took place. Some women of our company astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive." Then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow to believe that all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" Then, beginning with Moses, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they said, "Stay with us, because the day is nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at table, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. And he vanished from their sight. Here ends the reading. My dear friends, as we gather on this day, we remember that when a person dies, her life story quite often passes in front and before us, with all the joys and sorrows, the successes and the failures of that life. However, there are a lot of facts about a person's life that tell the real and more or less the full story about that individual. But at the best, as we gather here, whatever picture it is that we may hold in front of our eyes right now, Each one of us have but a little fragment of that person's story. And even the pattern, the full pattern of that person's life may elude us. It would seem that the full story of any person's life is known only to God. However, when we gather on an occasion like this, we become aware that the sad fact of all our stories is that it actually ends in death. Even if death comes naturally, at the end of a long and a full life, we do not like that the story must necessarily end the way it is intended to be. We want our stories always to be joyful and happy. We like, even with our fairy tale stories, happy endings. But when a story ends badly, no matter what height our stories might have taken us, it can leave feelings that sometimes we cannot even express in the sense in which we have experienced another person. And so if we have a picture of that, we can understand these two individuals on their way, almost as one would say, going back home to Emmaus. I like the reading when it says it is about 70 kilometers away from Jerusalem. I'm certain that some of you felt that you drove 70 kilometers from wherever you came this morning. So you can almost identify with these two individuals. The story of Jesus filled their lives. It's a story of inspiration and hope, of meaning. And yet now, with all the aspirations that they have had, that story too ended in death. The fact that Jesus there died such a violent and brutal death, and the sorrow and the emptiness that they experienced as a consequence of that, is what now is prevalent and real to them. And in that state of sorrow, of a story that seems to be shattered, Jesus seems to appear with them. But they, because they are in such deep sorrow, are not able to recognize him. And then he says to them, talk a bit more. Talk a bit more. Tell me more of the story. Almost as if he doesn't know the story. And you and I know what it's like when a person seems to be interested in me and want to know my story. I bubble, I'm overflowing. I want to tell simply because the other person shows a keen interest. And so they poured out the whole story. They told him all the good parts of that story, but then also they come to the very sad ending of that story. For them, the death of Jesus signified the end of the story, the end of a dream, the end of all hope, the end of everything. And now, having listened to them, Jesus took up the story, takes it further, takes them into all sorts of directions from the Old Testament, naming all the great prophets. And they feel even more uplifted because here is a person who has listened to their story of deep bereavement, sadness, and sorrow, and still brings out something different, something excited, somebody that seems to totally and completely immerse himself in their story as it is. And he asks such profound questions. He says to them, but was that not the way in which the story was intended to end? Was the Messiah not supposed to suffer so that he can enter into his glory? It is when he asked the profound questions that something different happened. It's almost as if scales from their, fall from their eyes, and they begin to see differently. It is when you go to your pastor, what a huge, huge burden. You know what you are supposed to be doing to resolve that, because it's in your subconsciousness. It's there. But through all the hours of anticipation and trying to grapple with the thing, but you need affirmation and confirmation. And when you open your story to your pastor or to your counselor or to your imam, what happens? As he enters into that, something amazing happens. You discover what is the course that you should take. But it has always been there. That person, by entering in the story, opens up that story just a bit more. And when they recognize them, they become so alive that they want to run back that 70 kilometers to tell the others about this incredible experience that they have had. What is it that you remember of our deceased sister? When you look at the life of Carol, how do you connect with that? What are the joys and the wonderful moments of celebrations that you remember? What are the moments of triumph, of victory? Person studying as a nurse, ending up in finance. Isn't that a wonderful thing? At a time when people believe that if you commit yourself to be a policeman, you will be a policeman for the rest of your life. So what is it that we connect with her story that lifts us a bit more? I remember my own experience of her was not necessarily direct, because we had so little time with each other. But on the day when I went to make the arrangements for the funeral of Joan, I discovered on that same day that Carol, virtually 3 days after that, passed away as well on the Saturday. So I said to the family, to those gathered with me, it will not be nice if we actually have these two funerals combined under the current circumstances. And then the response came, they were different people. And they had different and distinct wishes. And Carol has already laid out her full plan. Amazing, isn't it? Yes, we are unique. Each one of us have our own story, our own desires and hopes and aspirations. In the graffiti at the university, when students write all these things, then somebody would write something about identical, and somebody else would just write a footnote and an arrow and says, but similar is not identical. It's amazing. And so what you need to do today is to go with your fragment of Carol's story, whether it's joyful and hopeful and inspiration, whether it's painful or sorrowful, doesn't matter. But that you treasure your fragment of the story. The amazing thing about the gospel that we have read and all the other gospels is that Jesus communicates profoundly with us through stories. Let us therefore not let her stories vanish from our sight, but may we treasure it always in our memories. Now I need to put a full stop there, because I realize we're supposed to be done 11 o'clock and we got 10 minutes to go. I pray that God will bless his words to you and that you will always treasure the beautiful memories of Carol. We will now have the hymn, All to Jesus I Surrender. That will take about 3 minutes. And thereafter, we will invite Neville Eckrath to do the thanks. I will refuse to say how many minutes, obviously. No? So we now have the hymn, All to Jesus, I Surrender.
Good morning, everybody. I am acting on the instruction of Kayla and Brandon to just say a word of thanks. First of all, to all of you for making the time to come and spend with them, to say goodbye to their mom, to Dr. Rongsky. Am I saying that right?
Yes.
Sister Bonaparte, the Undertakers, Avbob, Father Frank Leonard, I nearly said Frank Sinatra. Uncle Michael Jessen, that comes from Kayla, not from me, so I'm not calling you uncle. Ashraf and Jeremy for the catering, Justin for the programs, and Auntie Lydia for always being there for my mother. I just want to end up by saying this to you and Kayla and to Brandon. It's a song, an old song that came out when I was a little boy. It's by a band called The Hollies. And it's called He Ain't Heavy, He Is My Brother. It starts by the road is long with many a winding turn. And when you sing it, when it says, he's my brother, put there, she's my mother. The road is going to be long and winding and hard for you. But always remember where you must focus on and who you want to focus it to, because she'll be watching over you. Just don't forget that. Thank you so much.
Give us faith so we'll be saved. In our faded prayer, by a chisel I know. Sento che ci
by what say it's exactly 2 minutes past 11, so we have done very well. Could I also just add a few words of thanks? Thank you to all of you for your incredible faithfulness to one another. Since the passing of Uncle Leslie, I've seen more or less the same faces over and over, and that speaks about a wonderful commitment and dedication to one another. To Michael, thank you for blessing us with your musical skills. I'm a great admirer, and I want to just say thank you for that. And then, you know, will you forgive me to say, nou het ek almal genoeg gehad van julle? You know, please, you got to give me a break now as a clan. But thank you, you know, for the wonderful generosity that you have shown me by inviting me into your space over the last three occasions, and for understanding that I am still finding my feet in this new congregation called St. Albans. You have been absolutely wonderful, and thanks for your support and for your encouragement. Okay, there will be barakat. Okay, good. Thank you, Neville. Can I just say that we will now ask the pallbearers to come forward, and we will leave on the hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. The committal will happen next door, and after the committal, I will then pronounce the final blessing. Could we please stand?